Rose-colored glasses are off. It's time to get real. Yet, we remain hopeful. Still, this is the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. I am your host, Temitayo Osinubi. Let's get to it. Welcome to episode 12 of the Marketing Disenchanted Podcast. Before I introduce this week's guest, I got to take a moment and express just what a humbling and marvelous experience launching this podcast has been. Some of the guests that I've had on thus far are bona fide heavy hitters in the professional digital marketing space, and they have just been as gracious and welcoming as you could possibly hope for. You know, Jason Falls, Douglas Carr, Ted Rubin. I mean, these are bona fide big dogs, and they've just been as nice and as welcoming and as approachable as a young professional could possibly hope for. And all of that goes double for my next guest, which is Mr. Mark Schaefer. Mark is a globally recognized author, speaker, educator, and business consultant. He gives Gary Vee a run for his money in terms of the hardest working man in the industry because he has consistently released a book every year since 2011. I mean, each and every year. That is no easy feat as someone who has wrote a book myself, because it took a year just to write our book. He's the author of some very similar works in the space, including The Tao of Twitter, Return on Influence, Born to Blog, Social Media Explained, and The Content Code. His last book, The Content Code, in particular, was really good. He talked about content shock, which, you know, every professional digital marketer is wrestling with. And he's working on a new book, big surprise, Known, which he'll discuss at the end of the show. So without further ado, let's hop into our interview with Mr. Mark Schaefer. Mark, thanks so much for taking the time.
I am delighted to be here. Thanks so much for having me.
Oh, you have no idea what a privilege it is to talk to you, because like we were briefly chatting about, I learned about you from Carrie O'Shea Gorgon. I went to Full Sail University and she was teaching in the master's program at the time. And so I've just been following your work for several years now. And also through Carrie, I met Rob Zelski, Rob Z,
who was great guy.
Yeah, he was working in marketing props until recently, and you know, he tells the whole story about how you gave him a day pass to South by Southwest, and that directly led to him working in marketing props. So, I've been running kind of in your shadow for some time now, so it's really just a great, great honor.
Well, no more. You're out of the shadows, and we're connected, and that leads to a friendship.
I'm telling you what,
and you're right down the road from me in Atlanta, so we need to get together sometime.
I look forward to it. Absolutely. Yeah. So you've done a lot of seminal work in the industry with content shock, and your book The Content Code, and by far you are, you know, in the upper echelon in a lot of people's opinions, but it wasn't always like that, and the road to digital marketing tends to be a winding one. So tell us that story. When did you first get bit by the bug, and how did you become enchanted with digital marketing?
Oh, well, it certainly has been a winding road. Well, I guess I want to start with I took a few marketing classes when I was in college and really kind of fell in love with the idea of marketing. But I was already so far through with my college degree that I couldn't change majors. I needed to get out and make some money because I was tired of being broke. So I got a job with a big company, and I met some people in marketing. And one day I walked into this huge manufacturing facility, and they were building this new plant. I think they were spending $50 million on this new facility. It was going to employ 200 new people. And the reason they were doing that is because this man who ended up being my mentor, this marketing professional, had this idea of this new product. And they were building this $50 million facility to make this new product and hiring all these people. And I thought, if that's what marketing does, that's what I want to do. That is the front lines of business, is creating new value, creating new ideas and products. And I have never looked back, and I have been in marketing more than 30 years, and I've loved every minute of it. My digital journey began, I had a traditional marketing job, and I can't remember the year. It was in the late 90s, I guess. And I talked to my boss, in my marketing job, I said, you know, there's this thing, this internet. I think there's something to it. I want, is it okay if I get a subscription to AOL and put it on my expense account? So I was the first person in my division to be on the internet, and I expensed it on my expense account. It was so just so weird to be on the internet, so exotic at that time. And then I had some ideas of how our company could do things on the internet, and that got some the attention of people in our in the corporation. I was with a Fortune 100 company, and long story short, I ended up running the department. So I was the global director of e-business for this company, was getting into digital marketing. I was responsible for CRM, and then started my own company about eight years ago now, I guess, a little over 8 years. And I'm working on a new book, and I'm talking to people who have become very, very successful in different sorts of careers on the internet. And one of the things I found everywhere, and this is certainly true for me, is that nobody starts as an expert. And we look up to these people. And I mean, you mentioned, you know, you've been following me, but I didn't start out as an expert. I've written a book on blogging. But when I started blogging, I didn't know anything about blogging. I was terrible. And even now I'm working on this new book, or the content code. All right. So by learning and writing this book, the content code, I developed new expertise, but I didn't have that when I started writing the book. I didn't really know where the book was going to go because I wanted the research to create the book. So becoming known, becoming an expert is a continuous process. Is a continuous process. And I think that's something that especially a lot of young people misunderstand. They don't think they have anything to add to the world. They're afraid, they're intimidated because they think, well, you know, look, everything's already been said. I'll never be one of these people. And the fact of the matter is you can be one of those people. Everybody has the opportunity today. We live in this amazing, amazing time where, you know, the power has shifted. When I was your age, when I was a young guy, the power was in the newspaper editor and the people in Wall Street and the guy who's going to give you a loan in the bank or not. That's where the power was. Today, the power shifted to us. You know, if you've got an internet connection, you can have a voice. You can create your own power. And I truly believe that. And I've seen that happen over and over again. It's just a matter of having the courage to do it and take that first step.
Sage advice. Very true. So when was the honeymoon over? When did you become disenchanted? Not necessarily disillusioned, but when did that, you know, sort of shiny veneer come off? Sort of like when you're married, you know, this new person, they can do no wrong. You're so in love. And then you get married and you find out that, you know, they fart and they snore like a dying moose. So when did stuff get real in digital marketing for you?
Yeah, that's really kind of interesting. It's an interesting question because I mean, I just see it. I see my journey as a path of continuous lessons, and I love it. I have fun every single day, and I'm still learning on everything that I do. I don't consider myself an expert. I just consider myself a student because everything is changing so fast. And I mean, I've made mistakes and. I think that sometimes the only thing that really kind of disappoints me is some of the personal behavior on the internet sometimes where that gets me down a little bit sometimes. It has nothing to do with the internet or business or marketing or my career. It's just that sometimes the way how people treat other people on the internet wears me down sometimes. And I truly believe that every single one of us has an opportunity to be positive and lift people up and create the kind of world and kind of life that we would like. And there are certain parts of the internet that are truly a cesspool, and that kind of wears on me a little bit. But in terms of me personally, I just go with the flow, really. I mean, I just learn and keep going, keep growing, and recognize where I need to learn more, where I need to be better, and then get after it. And, you know, hopefully I'm a better person and a better man and a better marketer this year than I was last year.
I can dig it, and I certainly agree. One of the things I really liked about Google Plus, well, I still like about Google Plus, is that you have to use your real name. So if you do something, that's not above board, or you go off on a foul tangent, like there's very real consequences versus Facebook or Twitter, where you can have a handle, Bay Boy getting money 2,000 or whatever, and then you do something bad, and then you just open up a new account and start all over. Now you can have multiple accounts on Google Plus, but they all have to say your real name. So definitely agree with that. So Mark, you are a man of a certain age. And if you had a time machine and you could go back and talk to your younger self, without causing any cataclysms or paradoxes, yes, I watched Doctor Who and I just gave you a TARDIS. What are the top three things you would tell yourself to help prepare for your career?
Well, the first thing I would tell my younger self is, hey, dude, you don't know shit. Because you got a long road ahead of you. And when I was young, I'd say particularly like in my 20s, I was really full of piss and vinegar, ready to take on the world and indestructible. Then I had a kind of a cataclysmic event in my life where my son was like I think he was 9 months old, and they thought he had a very, very serious illness. And they took my, my baby out of my arms and took him to this operating room, and that changed my whole life. And it's been changed permanently from that moment on. That basically, I realized nothing else mattered. You could take everything else in my life, but I just wanted that baby back. And so I think as long as you have those relationships in your life, protect those relationships and those moments, that keeps me centered. I think I don't know. I think throughout my life I've remained a pretty centered person. That's been important to me. I think I have a keen sense of where I fit in the world, and that's a very small role. I'm very happy and blessed that people seem to enjoy my work. I'm just trying to, nothing else really comes to mind as far as number two and number three, as far as advice to my younger self. I'd be stretching. I think I'd be making something up. So I think I would add value for with more value with the next question.
Absolutely, and I dig it. And thank you very much for sharing that personal story. I actually have a 7-month-old, and
Oh, good for you.
it's harrowing to think about something happening when they're that small, you know. So we're gonna take a short break, and then when we get back, we're gonna dive deeper with Mr. Mark Schaefer. So stick with me. In the last 3 months of the 2016 U.S. presidential election, fake news outperformed real news on Facebook. Now, don't worry, this is a podcast about marketing, not politics. But what I'm trying to pull out with that example is that most people can't call BS online when they see it. Now, this is in stark contrast to the whole un-college movement that favors finding information online, oftentimes for free, as opposed to paying for higher education. Now, that tactic can work, assuming you can call BS when you see it, which unfortunately most people just can't. The ability to call BS online, what we call digital discernment, is a skill, which means that it can be learned. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course to learn the skill of digital discernment. In this short course, taught by yours truly, I condense my over a decade of trial and error experience, as well as the skill I learned getting a degree in digital marketing for your benefit. Go to bit.ly.com/DMD course right now. That's bit.ly/D as in dog, M as in Mary, D as in dog course. And we're back. So, Mark, you, Gary V, and Tim Ferriss are chilling at the bar after a conference, having a straight talk, no BS mini mastermind. What would you say is severely lacking from the professional digital marketing space, and how would you brainstorm about correcting it?
Here is what is severely lacking in the digital marketing space, and that is professional education. Now, you mentioned that your hustle was getting a degree, and I admire that. And I think there's a place for a degree in this world. I know Gary doesn't. I don't know really where Tim sits on that subject. Do you? You know where Tim? Yeah. But I teach at the graduate level at Rutgers University, and they have an extraordinary program. But as I go and lecture around the country and around the world, I think the state of marketing education is pathetic at many, many universities. And I know one of the things that Rutgers does and one of the things that Full Sail does where you went is that they try to bring in practicing professionals. And where a lot of the other universities fall short is they look around and they say, we got to do something on digital marketing. Who's going to teach this stuff? They look at their tenured professors and they say, oh, you've been here 30 years, you do it. And that's it. And some major universities don't even have classes in digital marketing right now. So the state of education in our profession is pathetic. And this is showing up in the research where a lot of CMOs are saying, the biggest obstacle I have to my success is finding the people with the skills to do this. Mm-hmm. The CMO of, I believe it was Unilever, came out 2 weeks ago and he said, there's an entire group of people kind of between the ages of maybe 35 and 55, he said, who are faking their way through their career. The younger people are digital natives. So they're immersed in this stuff and they embrace it. The older people have kids who are immersed in it. So they're forced to be part of it. But he said this middle group, he said they don't have the skills they need. They haven't been immersed in technology to really embrace the skills they need to succeed in marketing. And so I think you look at the research and you look at a comment like that, and it kind of validates that you can't just hustle your way up. I mean, you've got to have some education. You've got to understand marketing and consumer behavior and how all these things fit together.
I tend to agree. I absolutely do. So without getting political, but by all means, express yourself because, you know, being candid is the whole point of this podcast. What's your take on the whole fake news backlash and then subsequent crackdown on Facebook? Because at first, Mark Zuckerberg sort of played it off. Oh, it's highly unlikely that Facebook had anything to do with the outcome. And then when the fake news numbers actually came out, BuzzFeed published the article, then he sort of backtracked and say, okay, we're going to roll out some sort of verification process of what's real and what's not. And I'm a Gemini, so I sort of oscillate between being the just straight First Amendment, no, Facebook is a platform only. They don't have any business trying to say what's true and what not. And then on the other hand, I'm like, Facebook is a digital property. And as a property owner, be it terrestrial or digital, you are responsible for what happens on your property. It's kind of like, let's say you have a pool in your backyard. I don't know if you do or not. And you're away on business and two teenage knuckleheads hop your fence so they can go skinny dipping and one of them drowns. Right. Mm-hmm. You put up a fence. They were trespassing. Doesn't matter. Yeah. It happened on your property. So you're responsible. So where do you kind of land on that?
I land in your second camp. It's like they're a publisher, and Zuckerberg vacillates on this. Early last year, I want to say, he said, "You know, we want to be the biggest publisher in the world. We want to be the biggest source of news in the world." He was putting tremendous pressure on traditional publications like the Wall Street Journal and New York Times and magazines to say, publish on Facebook, basically saying, give your readers to us, trust us, right? Then in June, he flip-flopped, and he was getting feedback from the readers saying, we don't want this kind of news in our news stream. We want to see grumpy cat and baby pictures. Mm-hmm. So he kind of backed off, and now traditional media doesn't really know what to do. But the fact of the matter is, Facebook is a publisher. They're the largest media outlet in the history of the world. And in the New York Times or the Wall Street Journal would not allow content in their platform that's fake, that's intimidating, that's bullying, that's even driven by terrorists. It can't happen. It won't happen. Mm-hmm. And the First Amendment provides a right for you to express an opinion. It doesn't force news outlets to publish every opinion. Right. You can be judicious. And it's funny, the Europeans always seem to be ahead of the Americans on these issues. And they've gone to Facebook and Google and these places that are publishing, and they're saying, they gave them a deadline. They said, you have got to take intimidating and bullying information, fake news off your sites. We are holding you responsible. And a couple universities just did a study over there, and they found that a year past their deadline, 60% of this hate speech and bullying was still coming through on Facebook. They hadn't put the resources toward it that they need to. So I'm kind of in your second camp, where it's Facebook now. I almost look at it that it should almost be like a regulated utility. And a lot of people will hate me for that, but it's kind of like electricity or having a telephone line. Those are regulated industries. And there are regulations around telephone services. There are regulations around television shows. I mean, you can't put nudity on a primetime television show. There are rules around that stuff because mm-hmm. they're trying to accommodate certain standards. Now, I mentor these young kids. Anybody with a smartphone and internet connection can access any kind of crap. Porn, hate stuff, they're exposed to everything today. And I think there needs to be, personally, I think there needs to be a crackdown on that stuff. And it doesn't mean an infringement on First Amendment rights. You can have both.
I tend to agree. You make a very compelling point.
You can have First Amendment rights, and you can still have civility.
Absolutely.
If you can have people, protesting, you can have racists and haters protesting, and they can say what they want to say, but you know what? They can't disrupt the public. They've got to have a permit. They've got to do it in a certain place. Mm-hmm. So, I mean, you can have First Amendment rights that protect all kinds of speech, but there's still guidelines. There are still boundaries to how and where you can do it.
You make a compelling argument, very much so. So one last question, and then I'll let you get back to your day, and I do appreciate you taking the time. But I am going to take just a few minutes to set it up because I want you to understand why I'm asking it the way I'm asking it and where I'm going. It's a modified version of the last question that John Lee Dumas asked in his Entrepreneur on Fire podcast. And in my personal and professional opinion, there's a severe gap in the professional digital marketing education space in terms of career trajectory. And by professional, I mean somebody who works in-house at an agency, brand, or corporation. I am not referring to digital entrepreneurship like somebody like a Pat Flynn or a John Lee Dumas, even though you can absolutely make the case that they're professionals because they operate at a very high level. It's not who I'm talking about. I'm talking about people with jobs, people mm-hmm. who get a W-2 or 1099 at the end of the year. So mm-hmm. just using my own journey as an analog, mm-hmm. you start mm-hmm. off meandering the wilds of Google for a year or 10, and mm-hmm. you might land on Businesses Grow. You might end up doing mm-hmm. Amway. Like, who knows, right? Mm-hmm. That's some mm-hmm. sort of shakeout either way. And at some point, you get serious and you decide to jump and really invest. And at that point, you kind of have two options. The first, you can do what I did, is you can go back to college to get a degree. But the cons with that is that it's very expensive. I had to borrow the better part of $60,000 to get my degree. And it's also time consuming because mm-hmm. even though Full Sail's degree program mm-hmm. is accelerated, it still took 30 months to complete. And mm-hmm. A lot can happen in 30 months in the online space. But mm-hmm. I'm a tiny minority in that mm-hmm. by far the more prevalent way that the industry educates itself and disseminates best in class practice is through conferences and seminars. The problem with that is that even though in aggregate it's a lot less than getting a degree, you got to have the money up front. So take a conference like a South by Southwest or a MozCon or a Marketing Pros B2B Forum, you're looking at between $500 and $1,500 just to get through the door. That doesn't include your flight, your hotel, Uber, food for however many days. After you add all that stuff back in, you're looking at between $3,000 and $5,000 on a single conference. And again, you gotta have that money up front. So what I'm really trying to do is I'm trying to crowdsource a way for people to professionalize themselves that doesn't include rolling the dice on Google, selling your firstborn to the Department of Education, or having to fork over a bunch of money up front for a conference. So now that I'm done rambling, the actual question is, imagine you woke up in a brand new world, identical to Earth, but you knew no one. You still have all the experience, skills, and knowledge you currently have, your food and shelter taken care of, but all you have is a laptop and no money. That's right. You are college freshman broke, baby. You got somewhere to lay your head, a meal plan, computer, Wi-Fi, and that's it. How would you build relationships with industry thought leaders over the next 30 days by working for free?
I think that's quite a proposition. And I appreciate your passionate lead up to that. You know, I think one of the biggest problems we have today is defining who's an industry thought leader. I mean, who really is a thought leader? So I think the most careful decision in that situation is to figure out who you're really going to connect to, who you're going to really follow and learn from. And it takes some critical thinking. And there's a lot of, I mean, there's a lot of charlatans out there. And they seem to be able to build an audience. But I think the key decision in that process would be to spend most of the time figuring out who are the real thought leaders out there, who are actually doing this stuff, you know, who are creating or original content that are contributing to the well-being instead of just, you know, regurgitating things that other people say 1,000 times. And then, you know, in terms of how do you connect to them in a meaningful way, it depends because I remember when I was just coming up, you know, everybody was all about, well, you know, engagement and community, and it's all about the conversation. And what I found is that it's not scalable. The more popular you get, the less you're able to engage. Right. Not because you don't have the will, not because your personality sucks. It's just because you have less hours in the day. And you know, when I was starting out, I was in a nightclub, and I could go around to the nightclub and I could shake everybody's hand and get to know their name. And now I'm in an arena, and all I can do is slap the hands of the people in the front row and say, "I love everybody else."
Right.
And so that's a real issue. Once you identify thought leaders, how do you connect with them in a meaningful way? And one of the things that I've seen is that there are a couple people I admire who do an excellent job at that. What they do is they try to find really just genuine, generous, selfless ways to find ways to help those people and get their attention. You know, one person read my Tao of Twitter book, and in the book I talk about authentic helpfulness. And this designer read the book, and he said, "That had such an impact on me. I've designed a new background image for your Facebook page because I think, you know, you don't really have a good image. So, I mean, here's something that goes with your book." And now we're connected. We've become friends. I've sent business to the guy. And lots of people do little things like that that just kind of touch you, stand out, and represent just a great heart. And I think that's what gets people's attention. What I often end my talks and workshops and classes with is encouraging students to be more human. I think that's the killer app as we go forward, is to find how can we force everything we do, put it through a filter of how can we be more human. Every piece of content, every interaction, every engagement. So I think that's the strategy I would have in your dystopian world. I would spend most of my time figuring out who really are the true thought leaders. And then I would spend the rest of my time thinking, how can I help these people in just a generous human-to-human way?
There you have it, folks, from the man himself. Mark, this has been tremendous. I greatly appreciate it. Please take a minute and talk about your upcoming book, Known. Tell us where we can get a hold of you, your Twitter handle, and your podcast. Where can we get some more of you?
You can find everything out about me at businessesgrow.com. I couldn't call it Schaefer.com because nobody could spell Schaefer. It's spelled so many ways. But right. I think most people can remember Businesses Grow, and you can find my books, my podcast, my blog, social media. The new book is called Known. It's going to be the handbook for unleashing a personal brand in the digital world. And it's kind of, I don't really like the word personal branding. It's kind of been beat up into something that's meaningless these days. But I think we all have an opportunity to have a voice, to have power in this world. And so what I've been wrestling with for the last couple of years is there a process every person could follow, or any person could follow, let's say, and become known? And so I've interviewed, I think I'm over 70 people at this point, from all different walks of life. And I've come to the conclusion that, yes, there is a process that people follow. And that's what the book is about, is teaching people how to become known. I think it's a scalable, repeatable process. Not everybody will be able to do it because it might not be the right time in their life to do it, or maybe they don't have the time to do it. But I think every person has the opportunity to do it.
There you have it, folks. You just got a master's class, and take him up on whatever offer he has. Go to businessesgrow.com, follow him on Twitter, listen to the Marketing Companion podcast. I listen to it myself, and the introductions are stellar, by the way.
Thanks.
And I really enjoy it. So, Mark, thanks again for taking the time.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
If you've enjoyed this episode of the Marketing Disenchanted podcast, consider becoming a patron at patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support helps with hosting the audio files, upgrading audio equipment, and so much more. And between you and me, my pledge levels are killing them. If you go look at other people's pledges and come back and look at mine, I'm a professional marketer, so you know I like my swag. I got t-shirts, USB thumb drives, not to mention my awesome products. So go to patreon.com/marketingdisenchanted. Your support is greatly appreciated. Thank you for doing me the high honor of listening to the very end. Please subscribe in iTunes, Stitcher, or your favorite podcasting app. Leave a 5-star rating and write a review telling people about my unmitigated awesomeness. It really helps out with getting the show shown. Follow me on Twitter at Tembo8482. That's T-E-M-B as in boy, O-8482. Or connect on LinkedIn, and I'll have my LinkedIn description in the show notes. And I'll see you next week.